morning.
Good morning.
Glad to see you all here today. Happy Thanksgiving. By way of announcement, the latest edition of Acts and Facts is here, so you can pick up a copy of that. Don't forget, there are still picture calendars and pocket calendars available. Picture calendars for this year, pocket calendars for next year. In your bulletins, you'll find this week's prayer sheet and also an envelope for the Women's Missionary Society meeting. So the offering today, if you put it in the envelope, it goes to the Women's Missionary Society. If you don't put it in the envelope, it goes to the church. Communion letters are also available. They'll be on the piano for you, so please pick those up to save the cost of postage. Please turn your Bibles to Psalm 100. We'll have our call to worship. Psalm 100, a psalm of praise. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Let's turn our celebration hymnals to hymn 788. Now thank we all our God. We'll stand and sing hymn 788.
Now thank we all our God with hearts and hands and voices. This things hath done, in whom his world rejoices, who from our mother's arms hath blessed us on our way with countless gifts of love, and still is ours today. Oh, may this bounteous God through all our life be near us. Ever joyful hearts and blessed peace to cheer us. Keep us in his grace and guide us when perplexed, and free us from all ills in this world and the next. All praise and thanks, O God, the Father, loving given, the Son, and him who reigns with them in highest heaven. Amen.
Please remain standing.
Amen.
Please remain standing for the doxology.
From whom all blessings flow, praise
Father in heaven, indeed this day we do come before thy presence with thanksgiving and a song. Father, we come with grateful hearts for all that thou art and all that thou dost. Father, we especially give thanks for the gift of thy Son, that through him we have eternal life. Through him, this world and all that are in it are sustained. Father, every good and perfect gift comes from thee. All that we are and all that we have is of thee. Father, we offer our praise, our adoration, and our thanksgiving this day. We ask thy presence with us as we worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be,
be seated. We wish you a blessed Thanksgiving today. It's always a joyful time of year when we set apart a very special time of thanks. We should be thankful every day and everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. But today we have the joy of giving a special time of Thanksgiving, remembering many years of past Thanksgivings here in our country, especially for the freedoms that we so much enjoy. And every year we read the various Thanksgiving proclamations that have been given over the centuries, declaring our thanks to the Almighty God. The first of those that we read each year is the Mayflower Compact. The Mayflower Compact was the first governing document of the Plymouth Colony. It was written by the colonists, later known together in history as the Pilgrims, who crossed the Atlantic on the Mayflower. It was signed by 41 of the male passengers on November 11th, 1620, as dated by the old Julian calendar. On the Gregorian calendar, it occurred November 21st, the calendar that was adopted in England in 1752. As you know, it was signed aboard the ship in what is now Provincetown Harbor near Cape Cod. And so I read it this morning. November 11, 1620, Governor William Bradford. In the name of God, amen. We whose names are underwritten, the loyal subjects of our dread sovereign, Lord King James, by the grace of God of Great Britain, France, and Ireland, King, defender of the faith, etc. Having undertaken, for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith, and honor of our king and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia, do by these presents, solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and of one another, covenant and combine ourselves together into a civil body politic for our better ordering and preservation and furtherance of the ends aforesaid, and by virtue hereof to enact, constitute, and frame such just and equal laws, ordinances, acts, constitutions, and offices from time to time, as shall be thought most meet and convenient for the general good of the colony, unto which we promise all due submission and obedience, in witness whereof we have hereunder subscribed our names at Cape Cod, the 11th of November, in the year of the reign of our sovereign Lord King James of England, France, and Ireland, the 18th, and of Scotland, the 54th, Anno Domini 1620. John Carver. William Bradford. Edward Winslow, William Brewster, Isaac Alterton, Miles Standish, John Alden, Samuel Fuller, Christopher Martin, William Mullins, William White, Richard Warren, John Howland, Stephen Hopkins, Edward Tilley, John Tilley, Francis Cook, Thomas Rogers, Thomas Tinker, John Rigdale, Edward Fuller, John Turner, Francis Eaton, James Chilton, John Craxton, John Billington, Moses Fletcher, John Goodman, Gregory Priest, Thomas Williams, Gilbert Winslow, Edmund Margeson, Peter Brown, Richard Bittersridge, George Soule, Richard Clark, Richard Gardner, John Allerton, Thomas English, Edward Doughty, and Edward Leicester. 1 year later, in 1621, the first Thanksgiving Day was officially held by the Pilgrims. This was followed by many times of Thanksgiving, but the first known and recorded official public Thanksgiving proclamation was announced 50 years later in 1671. This was on June 29, 1671, by the Charlestown, Massachusetts City Colony, or Council, excuse me. The Holy God, having by a long and continual series of his afflictive dispensations, in and by the present war with the heathen natives of this land, written and brought to pass bitter things against his own covenant people in this wilderness, yet so that we evidently discern that in the midst of his judgments, he hath remembered mercy, having remembered his footstool in the day of his sore displeasure against us for our sins, with many singular intimations of his fatherly compassion and regard, reserving many of our towns from desolation threatened and attempted by the enemy, and giving us, especially of late, with many of our confederates, many signal advantages against them, without such disadvantage to ourselves as formerly we have been sensible of. If it be the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed, it certainly bespeaks our positive thankfulness when our enemies are in any measure disappointed or destroyed. And fearing the Lord should take notice under so many intimations of his returning mercy, we should be found an insensible people, as not standing before him with thanksgiving, as well as lading him with our complaints in time of pressing afflictions. The council has thought meet to appoint and set apart the 29th day of this instant June as a day of solemn thanksgiving and praise to God for such his goodness and favor, many particulars of which might be instanced, but we doubt not those who are sensible of God's afflictions have been diligent to espy him returning to us, and that the Lord may behold us as a people offering praise and thereby glorifying him. The council doth commend it to the respective ministers, elders, and people of this jurisdiction, solemnly and seriously to keep the same, beseeching that being persuaded by the mercies of God, we may all, even this whole people, offer up our bodies and souls as a living and acceptable service unto God by Jesus Christ. Amen. We find the 1777 Congressional Thanksgiving Proclamation on November 1, 1777 by Henry Lorenz, the President of the Continental Congress. For as much as it is the indispensable duty of all men to adore the superintending providence of Almighty God, remember this was written in Congress, to acknowledge with gratitude their obligation to him for benefits received, and to implore such further blessings as they stand in need of, and it having pleased him in his abundant mercy, not only to continue to us the innumerable bounties of his common providence, it is therefore recommended to the legislative or executive powers of these United States to set apart Thursday, the 18th day of December next, for solemn thanksgiving and praise, that with one heart and one voice the good people may express the grateful feelings of their hearts and consecrate themselves to the service of their divine benefactor, and that together with their sincere acknowledgments and offerings they may join the penitent confession of their manifold sins, whereby they had forfeited every favor and their humble and earnest supplication that it may please God through the merits of Jesus Christ mercifully to forgive and blot them out of remembrance, that it may please Him graciously to afford His blessings on the governments of these states respectively, and prosper the public council of the whole, to inspire our commanders both by land and sea, and all under them with that wisdom and fortitude which may render them fit instruments under the providence of Almighty God, to secure these United States, the greatest of all human blessings, independence and peace. That it may please Him to prosper the trade and manufacture of the people and the labor of the husbandman, that our land may yield its increase to take schools and seminaries of education so necessary for cultivating the principles of true liberty, virtue, and piety under His nurturing hand, and to prosper the means of religion for the promotion of an enlargement of that kingdom which consisteth, quote, in righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, unquote. And it is further recommended that servile labors such as recreation, though at other times innocent, may be unbecoming the purpose of this appointment, be omitted in so solemn an occasion. By order of Congress, Henry Lawrence, President, Continental Congress, November 1st, 1777. We move down through history a few years to the next presidential Thanksgiving proclamation by President George Washington. Whereas it is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey His will, to be grateful for His benefits, and humbly to implore His protection and favor, and whereas both houses of Congress have, by their joint committee, requested me, quote, to recommend to the people of the United States a day of public thanksgiving and prayer to be observed by acknowledging with grateful hearts the many and signal favors of Almighty God, especially by affording them an opportunity peaceably to establish a form of government for their safety and happiness, unquote. Now, therefore, I do recommend and assign Thursday, the 26th day of November next, to be devoted by the people of these states to the service of that great and glorious being who is the beneficent author of all the good that was, that is, or that will be, that we may then all unite in rendering unto Him our sincere and humble thanks for His kind care and protection of the people of this country previous to their becoming a nation, for the signal and manifold mercies and the favorable interpositions of His providence in the course and conclusion of the late war, for the great degree of tranquility, union, and plenty which we have since enjoyed, for the peaceable and rational manner in which we have been enabled to establish constitutions of government for our safety and happiness, and particularly the national one now lately instituted for the civil and religious liberty which we are blessed, and the means we have of acquiring and diffusing useful knowledge, and in general, for all the great and various favors which He has been pleased to confer upon us. And also, that we may then unite in most humbly offering our prayers and supplications to the great Lord and ruler of nations, and beseech Him to pardon our national and other transgressions, to enable us all, whether in public or private stations, to perform our several and relative duties properly and punctually, to render our national government a blessing to all the people by constantly being a government of wise, just, and constitutional laws, discreetly and faithfully executed and obeyed, to protect and guide all sovereign nations, especially such as have shown kindness unto us, and to bless them with good governments, peace, and concord, to promote the knowledge and practice of true religion and virtue, and the increase of science among them and us, and generally to grant unto all mankind such degree of temporal prosperity as He alone knows to be best. Given under my hand at the city of New York, the 3rd day of October in the year of our Lord, 1,700 and 89, signed George Washington. And because we are in New Jersey, we read the New Jersey Governor's Thanksgiving Proclamation of 1791, just 3 years later, Governor William Patterson. By His Excellency William Patterson, Esquire, Governor, Captain General, and Commander-in-Chief in and over the State of New Jersey and territories thereunto belonging, Chancellor and Ordinary in the same. Proclamation. Whereas it is at all times our duty to approach the throne of Almighty God with gratitude and praise, but more especially in seasons of national peace, plenty, and prosperity, I have therefore thought fit by and with the advice and consent of the Honorable the Privy Council to assign Thursday the 8th of December next to be set apart and observed as a day of public thanksgiving and prayer for the great and manifold mercies conferred upon this land and people, and particularly for the abundant produce of the earth during the present year, for the spirit of industry, sobriety, and economy which prevails, for the stability and extension of our national credit and commerce, for the progress of literature, arts, and sciences, and for the good order, peace, and plenty, and the civil and religious liberty with which we are blessed. And also that we may unite in our supplications and humbly implore the Almighty Ruler of the universe that He would be pleased to continue His protection and goodness to this land and people, to smile upon all schools and seminaries of learning, to promote agriculture, manufactures, and commerce, to illuminate and guide our public councils, to bless our national and state governments, to enable us to discharge our official, social, and relative duties with diligence and fidelity, to eradicate prejudice, bigotry, and superstition, to advance the interest of religion and the knowledge and practice of virtue, listen carefully, and for this purpose to pour out His Holy Spirit on all ministers of the gospel, to spread the saving light thereof to the most distant parts of the earth. Given under my hand and seal at arms at Trenton, the 21st day of November, in the year of our Lord, 1791, William Patterson, by His Excellency's command, Bowes Reed, Secretary. That brings us to a proclamation given in the middle of the Civil War, during a time of great suffering and grief. The 1863 Presidential Thanksgiving Proclamation of President Abraham Lincoln, given October 3rd, 1863. The year that is drawing towards its close has been filled with the blessings of fruitful fields and healthful skies. To these bounties, which are so constantly enjoyed that we're prone to forget the source from which they come, others have been added, which are of so extraordinary a nature that they cannot fail to penetrate and soften even the heart which is habitually insensible to the ever-watchful providence of Almighty God. In the midst of a civil war of unequaled magnitude and severity, which has sometimes seemed to foreign states to invite and provoke their aggression, peace has been preserved with all nations. Order has been maintained, the laws have been respected and obeyed, and the harmony has prevailed everywhere except in the theater of military conflict. While that theater has been greatly contracted by the advancing armies and navies of the Union, needful diversions of wealth and of strength from the fields of peaceful industry to the national defense have not arrested the plow, the shuttle, or the ship. The axe had enlarged the borders of our settlements, and the mines, as well of iron and coal as of precious metals, have yielded even more abundantly than heretofore. Population has steadily increased, notwithstanding the waste that has been made in the camp, the siege, and the battlefield, and the country. Rejoicing in the consciousness of augmented strength and vigor, it permitted to expect continuance of years with large increase of freedom. No human counsel hath devised, nor hath any mortal hand worked out these great things. They are the gracious gifts of the Most High God, who, while dealing with us in anger for our sins, hath nevertheless remembered mercy. It has seemed to me fit and proper that they should be solemnly, reverently, and gratefully acknowledged as with one heart and voice by the whole American people. I do therefore invite my fellow citizens in every part of these United States, and also those who are at sea and those who are sojourning in foreign lands, to set apart and observe the last Thursday of November next as a day of thanksgiving and praise to our beneficent Father who dwelleth in the heavens. And I recommend to them that while offering up the ascriptions justly due to him for such singular deliverances and blessings, they do also with humble penitence for our national perverseness and disobedience commend to his tender care all those who have become widows, orphans, mourners, or sufferers in the lamentable civil strife in which we are unavoidably engaged, and fervently implore the interposition of the Almighty Hand to heal the wounds of the nation and to restore it as soon as may be consistent with the divine purposes to fulfill enjoyment of peace, harmony, tranquility, and union. In testimony whereof I have hereunto set my hand and caused the seal of the United States to be affixed, done at the city of Washington this third day of October, in the year of our Lord, 1863, and of the independence of the United States, the 88th. Signed, Abraham Lincoln. That was the proclamation that actually established Thanksgiving Day as a national annual holiday at the height of the war between the states. And now in contrast, sadly, we come to the presidential proclamation for 2016 by President Barack Obama. Which basically thanks God for illegal aliens and immigrants without excluding ISIS. Nearly 400 years ago, a small band of pilgrims fled persecution and violence and came to this land as refugees in search of opportunity and freedom to practice their faith. If you will recall the Mayflower Compact, it began by ascribing thanksgiving to God for our dread Lord Sovereign, King James. Yes, they wanted religious freedom, but they were not like the so-called refugees we have of today. Though the journey was rough and their first winter harsh, the friendly embrace of an indigenous people, the Wampanoag, who offered gracious lessons in agriculture and crop production, led to their successful first harvest. The pilgrims were grateful they could rely on the generosity of the Wampanoag people, without whom they would not have survived the first year in the new land. And together they celebrated this bounty with a festival that lasted for days and prompted the tradition of an annual day of giving thanks. To whom? This history teaches us that the American instinct has never been to seek isolation in opposite corners. It is to find strength in our common creed and forge unity from our great diversity. On that very first Thanksgiving celebration, these same ideals brought together people of different backgrounds and beliefs, and every year since, with enduring confidence in the power of faith, love, gratitude, and optimism, this force of unity has sustained us as a people. It has guided us through times of challenge and change and allowed us to see ourselves in those who come to our shores in search of a safer, better future for themselves and their families. On this holiday, we count our blessings and renew our commitments in giving back. We give thanks for our troops and our veterans and their families, who give of themselves to protect the values we cherish. For first responders, for teachers and engaged Americans who serve their communities, and for the chance to live in a country founded on the belief that all of us are created equal. By whom? But on this day of gratitude, we are also reminded that securing these freedoms and opportunities for all our people is an unfinished task. We must reflect on all we have been afforded while continuing the work of ensuring no one is left out or left behind. A tip to Common Core Education. Because of all who they are and where they come from. Who they are and where they come from. For generations, our nation's progress has been carried forward by those who act on obligations we have to one another. Each year on Thanksgiving, the selflessness and decency of the American people, no repentance for sin, surfaces in food banks and shelters across our country, in time spent caring for the sick and the stranger, and in efforts to empathize with those with whom we disagree, and recognize, unless you're conservative, that every individual is worthy of compassion and care. As we gather in the company of our friends, families, and communities, just as the Pilgrims and the Wampanoag did centuries ago, let us strive to lift up others, promote tolerance, read that any way you want, and inclusiveness, and give thanks to whom for the joy and love that surrounds all of us. Now therefore, I, Barack Obama, President of the United States of America, by virtue of the authority vested in me by the Constitution and laws of the United States, we'll listen to them now, do hereby proclaim November 24, 2016 as a National Day of Thanksgiving. I encourage the people of the United States to join together, whether in our homes, places of worship, community centers, or any place of fellowship for friends and neighbors, and give thanks for all we have received in the year past, express appreciation to those whose lives enrich our own, and share our bounty with others. In witness whereof I have hereunto set my hand this 23rd day of November, in the year of our Lord, 2016, and of the independence of the United States of America, the 241st. Barack Obama. Since he never mentioned God, even in the context of the Pilgrims, is it permitted to ask who is his Lord when he says, "Year of our Lord"? Please take your hymnals and turn to 797. We'll stand to sing all the verses of "Come Ye Thankful People, Come," hymn number 797.
Come, ye thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest full. All is safely gathered in, and all winter's hoarse begin. God our Maker doth provide, for our wants to be supplied. Come to God's own temple, come, praise the song of harvest song. All the world is God's own field, fruit of joy is praise to Him. We can test together soon, on to joy or sorrow come. First the plain and then the ear, then the full-born shall appear. Light of harvest, grant that we wholesome grain and pure may be. For the Lord our God shall come, and shall take his harvest full. From his field shall in that day all offenses purge away. Give his angels charge at last, in the five waters go cast. But the fruitful is the store in his garden evermore. Even so, Lord, quickly come to thy final harvest home. Gather all thy people in, free from sorrow, free from sin. There forever pure.
scripture reading for today comes to us from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. The message will be entitled, a little later in the service, Thanksgiving in Times of Trouble. This gives us a good introduction to that. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. God's word for his people. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy our brother, unto the church of God which is at Corinth, with all the saints which are in all Achaia. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also aboundeth by Christ. And whether we be afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effectual in the enduring of the same suffering which we also suffer. Or whether we be comforted, it is for your consolation and salvation. And our hope of you is steadfast, knowing that as ye are partakers of the sufferings, so shall ye be also of the consolation. For we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble, which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out of measure above strength, insomuch that we despaired even of life. For we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God which raiseth the dead, who delivereth us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that he will deliver us. Ye also helping together by prayer for us, that for the gift bestowed upon us by the means of many persons, thanks may be given by many on our behalf. Amen. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May he bless our hearts with a deeper understanding of it. Amen. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you this day offering our thanksgiving and our praise. Father, let not our hearts be insensible to the signal mercies of Almighty God, as Abraham Lincoln said, but help us to be sensitive to the fact that your blessings are all around us. Help us to acknowledge not merely other people, but to acknowledge you as the sovereign Almighty God of the universe, who not only created and sustains all things, but who has given to us the very special blessing of living in this country at this time in history, giving to us the religious freedom that we currently so much enjoy, giving to us life and health and strength, enabling us to be here in this place this day, daily guiding us, guarding us, protecting us, providing for us, giving us opportunities for service, giving us opportunities for praise, giving us opportunities for fellowship one with another, giving us opportunities to do that which is right in your sight, and then graciously giving us heavenly rewards for doing what you yourself have empowered us to do. We thank you for our land, Father, for our country. Though we do not deserve it, we pray your blessings upon it. We come confessing our sins individually and corporately. Oh, that our leaders might see their own sin and the sin which they have opened up and spewed upon this land from every branch of our federal government, so that today decadence and wickedness, depravity and horrible darkness not only encroach, but reign in certain areas of our country. Father, we pray for the salvation of our current president and vice president and Supreme Court and senators and representatives, for our governor, lieutenant governor, and all those in lower offices, for our county governments and municipal governments, that we might lead quiet and peaceable lives in godliness and honor. Father, we pray for the incoming administration, that you'll give them wisdom in the things that they do, that you cause them to keep the promises that they have made and upon which your people who voted for them have relied. Father, we pray for your hedge of protection about them. We know there are many evil people who would seek to somehow eradicate them, cause them to stumble, cause them to bring shame not only to themselves but to this country. We thank you that it appears that you have given us a reprieve from what we have suffered in these past 8 years. And so, Father, we pray for your blessings on the incoming administration. We pray for the judicial appointments which will be made as a result of that, that you would give us wise Supreme Court justices who go by the Constitution, which was based upon your word. Father, we pray for each one of us here that we might not squander the opportunities that we currently have for serving Jesus Christ. We focus so much on temporal things. We focus so much on carnal pleasure. We focus so much on the things of earth rather than on the things of heaven. We humbly confess our sin. Not just the little stuff, but the big stuff that we hide. And as we confess it, truly, with full hearts, we know that you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We thank you for that, Father, because it is a gift not earned. We thank you for our gracious salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son. He saved us, not we ourselves. We had nothing to do with it. He died in our place before we were ever conceived and paid for all of our sins, not just part of them. And he loved us and irresistibly drew us to himself and regenerated us by the Spirit of God and gave us saving faith and brought us into the family of God and set before our eyes and a new goal, empowered by the Holy Spirit to serve, and then that ultimate destination of heaven. We thank you, Father, for you are good and we are evil, and yet you have had mercy upon us. Father, I pray that you will cause our hearts to be open and bear before you the living God this day. That all that we do, all that we say, all that we think, all of our motives, all of our attitudes would be under the control of the Holy Spirit of Almighty God. And that all across this land, your people would this day be praying, even as so many of our great presidents have requested, would be praying for this country and praying, Father, for opportunities to share Christ, that the ministers of the gospel would be encouraged to spread abroad the good news that Jesus saves. Father, we thank you for your kindness to us. And we pray that you might honor and glorify your name in all that is done and said and thought in this service. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. As our ushers are coming forward this morning to receive our morning gifts and offerings, We're once again reminded of the great truth of the gospel, that salvation is a free gift from God. It's not of works. You don't earn it. But if you have a thankful heart, if you have a grateful heart, if you have a heart filled with love, you'll want to give. It's a special day, a special time of thanksgiving. As Brother McCoy mentioned a few minutes ago, there are specially marked WMS envelopes in your bulletins. If you would like to give toward the Women's Missionary Society, you may use those envelopes. The offerings that are not in the envelopes will be going to the church, or if they're in a different envelope, go to some other designated fund. But those are there for you to be able to support the work of missions through our missionary society here at the church. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of offering. We pray for your blessings upon it, that you will bless those who give to the glory of Jesus Christ, for we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come of thee, O Lord, and divine own have we given thee. Amen.
Please remain standing and take your hymnals and turn, not your hymnals, your bulletins, and turn to the hymn which is on the back of the bulletin, the hymn, Thanks to God for My Redeemer. It's on the back of your bulletin.
Thanks to God for my Redeemer, thanks to God thou dost provide. Thanks for times but no memory, thanks for Jesus by my side. Thanks for pleasant balmy springtime, thanks for dark and dreary fall. Thanks for tears by now forgotten, thanks for peace within my soul. Thanks for prayers that thou hast answered, thanks for what thou dost deny. Thanks for storms that I have weathered, thanks for all thou dost supply. Thanks for pain and thanks for pleasure, thanks for comfort in despair. Thanks for grace that none can measure, thanks for love beyond compare. Thanks for roses by the wayside, thanks for thorns their stems contain. Thanks for home and thanks for fireside, thanks for home, that sweet refrain. Thanks for joy and thanks for sorrow, thanks for heavenly peace within. Thanks for hope in the tomorrow, thanks for all eternity. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. I guess we add that one to the last line there. Thanks, you may be seated. All right, please take your Bibles and turn back to that portion of Scripture that we read just a few moments ago, over in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11, the message today entitled, Thanksgiving in Times of Trouble. The grateful spirit of thanksgiving in the United States, as brought to our continent by our European ancestors, dates back over four centuries. It dates not merely to the pilgrims, although it is their celebration that we remember, but other thanksgivings are also notable. In 1564, the French Huguenot Protestant colonists celebrated a day of thanksgiving at St. Augustine, Florida. Since I'm from Texas, I must at least mention a few early special Thanksgiving days that were held there. In 1541, the Spanish explorer Coronado celebrated a day of thanksgiving with 1,500 of his soldiers at the Palo Duro Canyon in Texas. Another one, in 1598, another Spanish explorer, Juan de Oñate, and his expedition held a Thanksgiving Day celebration in El Paso, Texas. Didn't know about those, I bet. I suspect you didn't learn about those particular Thanksgiving Days in your New Jersey textbooks when you were in grade school. Others that may be more familiar to you include the Thanksgiving Day that was celebrated in by the Jamestown settlers when they landed in 1607 at Cape Henry in Virginia. Not long after that, in 1619, the settlers at Berkeley Plantation, Virginia, held another joyful Thanksgiving celebration. For the most famous Thanksgiving Day, and the day we look back to in our cultural current celebration, dates back to the Pilgrims, that hearty band of brave souls who courageously left family, friends, homes, wealth, the temporal things of earth, and all the comforts that they had known. I wonder if we would have done it. To plunge into the unknown and frightening new world in search of religious freedom and the right to worship God according to the Bible. We'll speak of them in just a few moments, but first, we've just read our key text for today related to thanksgiving and suffering, and in that text, the principal verses are verses 8 through 10. For we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble, which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out of measure, above strength, insomuch that we despaired even of life. But we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God which raiseth the dead, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust, he will yet deliver us, ye also helping together by prayer for us, that for the gift bestowed upon us by the means of many persons, thanks may be given by many on our behalf. Now, Paul has said a great deal here in these opening verses about his own personal suffering. Do we happen to know anything about what that suffering was? Yes, in just 11 chapters later, the Apostle Paul describes it for us. And yet he gave thanks in the midst of this. Are they Hebrews? So am I. This is chapter 11, beginning in verse 22. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors more abundant. In stripes above measure. I can't even count the number of times I've been beaten. In prison more frequent. In deaths often. Of the Jews 5 times received I 40 stripes save one. Thrice I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I've been in the deep. In journeyings often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils by mine own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. That's nothing, says Paul, beside those things which are without. That which cometh on me daily, the care of all the churches. Who is weak and I am not weak? Who's offended and I burn not? If I must needs glory, I will glory of the things which concern my infirmities. It gives you a general idea of what Paul's talking about when he talks about his troubles, his sufferings, and yet he gave thanks. Even through all those things, and even though he personally suffered them, he was able to write in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Paul emphasizes the all things in Ephesians as well. In Ephesians 5:20 we read, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Did you notice in those two verses that there are no exceptions in the events of life where we can be unthankful? no exceptions. Did you catch what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5:18? There is never a time of trouble or circumstance of life that is outside of the will of God. And God has promised to give us the grace to face every trouble that comes our way with thanksgiving. That's incredible. But we've got to ask the question, why is it possible? And the answer is very clear in Scripture. It's because God guarantees victory. Not just survival, God guarantees victory in every trial of life, including the day that we face the ultimate enemy of death. Remember what Paul wrote in that great resurrection chapter, 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 57, "But thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Thanksgiving. Why? Because of victory. Not just survival. Paul emphasizes this great truth again in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. "Now thanks be to God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ." That's victory. That's the man who just wrote about in 1 Corinthians all those horrendous things that we just read. "And maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place." Remember, those words were written by a man who suffered what might even be called heroic levels of suffering. It was the kind of thing we might expect of Hercules, Samson, the Titans, the hardened warriors of Sparta, the elite imperial guards of Rome, or the legendary women warriors of Norse mythology, the Valkyries. But it wasn't written by a person like that. Those words were written by a tiny little Jew who was an academic, a bookworm, a scholar, not a warrior. These words were written by a puny little Benjaminite who was practically blind. This confident, energetic declaration was written by a feeble munchkin who rarely got a square meal and almost had to live like a homeless derelict, wandering into the most awkward and dangerous situations. Thanksgiving in times of trouble. Does that strike you as somewhat incongruous? It really shouldn't. Did you know that the first American Thanksgiving that we've referred to of with the Pilgrims was preceded by a time of intense suffering and death? And yet the Pilgrims were able to give thanks and see the incredible providence and divine intervention of God. The Pilgrims set sail for America on September 6, 1620. For 2 months, they braved the harsh elements of a storm-tossed sea. Upon disembarking at Plymouth Rock, they held a prayer service and then hastily began building shelters. However, they were nearly unprepared for the viciously harsh New England winter. Death stalked the land with his grim sickle. Nearly half of them died before the following spring. But they never gave up hope, faith, thanksgiving, or courage. As the warmth of spring began to melt the frozen earth, they were surprised to the bottom of their weathered boots when an Indian named Somerset walked into their pitiful little settlement and greeted them in English. Somerset was an intelligent man who had learned the English language from fishermen, trappers, and traders. After seeing their plight, Somerset left the rude makeshift shelters the Pilgrims had built. They wondered if they would ever see him again. But just 1 week later, Somerset returned with one of his close friends named Squanto, who was also able to communicate with the Pilgrims in their own tongue. God had already been preparing the heart of Squanto to respond to the gospel. And of course, the Pilgrims were ready to share the good news of salvation. These two men, Somerset and Squanto, provided the bridge that formed a friendship and a long-lasting peace treaty between the Pilgrims and the Wampanoag Indians. Not long after that, Squanto trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. This was the man that God used to show the Pilgrims how to live in the new world. Governor William Bradford described Squanto as, quote, "a special instrument sent of God for our good, and never left us till he died," unquote. His salvation was genuine. And I expect
to see him someday in heaven as one of the great men whom God used to establish the United States of America as a Christian nation. That summer, the summer of 1621, following the dreadful winter of 1620, the pilgrims, still persevering in prayer and assisted by their new Indian friends, reaped a bountiful harvest. Indeed, the pilgrims deeply appreciated the help of the Wampanoag, which had been given to them, but that did not blind them to the fact that in reality, the fruitful harvest had been by a gracious and undeserved gift from the hand of Almighty God. As the pilgrim Edward Winslow, later to become the governor, wrote, quote, "God be praised, we had a good increase of Indian corn," and, quote, "by the goodness of God, we are far from want," unquote. To express their thanksgiving to God, the grateful pilgrims declared a three-day time of thanksgiving in December 1621, which included lobster, oysters, clams, turkey, cornbread, berries, deer, and other wonderful New World foods. The young men let off steam in multiple athletic contests, and the women cooked and enjoyed the fellowship. This is what we remember with our Thanksgiving feast, fellowship, and watching the turkey bowl on TV, for those of you who are carnal enough to own a TV. But other times, the stress and hardship loomed on the horizon. Just 2 years later, in 1623, the pilgrims experienced a severe, extended, and prolonged drought. They knew that unless God sent rain, there would be no harvest, and they would again be faced with a devastating winter filled with death and starvation. This time, rather than holding a feast, the pilgrims soberly gathered for a time of corporate prayer and fasting, beseeching God to intervene and send rain. Even as earlier they had gratefully acknowledged that he was the one who sent them their initial bounty, they knew that he could chasten them for their sins and he could withhold his blessings. Friends, the pilgrims believed in the true sovereign God of the Bible. They understood the declaration of the Apostle Paul in Acts 14, that only God could give rain and fruitful harvest, and that when he did so, it would be a witness to unbelievers. That's what the New Testament specifically says, Acts 14, 17. Nevertheless, he left not himself without witness, in that he did good and gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. He did it for a witness. Listen to what it was. The Indians were curious to see what would happen because the pilgrims were quite open about what they planned to do. The pilgrims fully expected God to hear their prayers and answer with rain. At that point, many of the Indians became skeptical about the God of the pilgrims. Could he really do such a thing as bring rain without all the traditional sacrifices and rituals and shamanistic ceremonies? Yet at the call of Governor Bradford, the pilgrims gathered openly for a time of prayer and fasting to seek God's direct intervention. They never doubted that God would hear and answer their prayers. Almost immediately after the prayer and fasting, and to the utter amazement of the Indians who witnessed the scene, clouds appeared in the skies, and a gentle and steady rain began to fall. Listen to the words that Governor Bradford wrote upon this occasion. Quote, "It came without either wind or thunder or any violence, and by degrees in abundance, so that ye earth was thoroughly wet and soaked therewith, which did so apparently revive and quicken ye decayed corn and other fruits, as was wonderful to see, and made ye Indians astonished to behold. And afterwards the Lord sent them such seasonable showers, with interchange of fair warm weather, as through his blessing caused a fruitful and liberal harvest, to their no small comfort and rejoicing," unquote. Indeed, God had not left himself without a witness. Just as the Apostle Paul explained in Acts 14, and seeing his direct intervention and action in response to the prayers and fastings of his people, many of the Indians were drawn to the true God and away from their pagan deities. The threatening drought that would have brought more suffering was averted, not only for the benefit of the pilgrims, but for the saving benefit of many of the Indians. In everything, the pilgrims could give thanks, For this experience proved to the Indians that the God of the Pilgrims was greater than the traditional pagan gods that their ancestors had worshipped. And so the Pilgrims established an official annual Thanksgiving Day, which was then copied by the other New England colonies, who also established it as a regular festival of giving thanks to God. Remember, when you do what is right, it will affect others. One day, among the Pilgrims, spread to the other colonies. The New England Days of Thanksgiving spread south at the time of the American Revolution to become a national day of Thanksgiving, with Congress issuing 7 separate proclamations for fasting and prayer plus days of Thanksgiving, making a total of 15 prayer proclamations issued by Congress during the War for Independence. The very first national Thanksgiving occurred in 1789 with the commencement of the federal government following the great time of suffering during the War for Independence. In fact, according to the Congressional Record for September 25, 1789, a call for a national day of Thanksgiving was the very first act the framers approved after they completed the Bill of Rights. The very first act after approving the Bill of Rights. By 1815, the various state governments in the United States had issued at least 1,400 official prayer proclamations, half for times of thanksgiving and prayer, and the other half for times of fasting and prayer. Historically, our great nation has understood the connection between suffering and responding with a thankful heart, thanking God for all of his good benefits, which sadly we tend to overlook when the temporal affairs of earth seem out of order. In fact, one of the most remarkable Thanksgiving proclamations in the history of our nation was made by President Abraham Lincoln in 1863. I read it just a few moments ago. It was made in a time of suffering. Thanksgiving in the midst of suffering. Remember, that's our message for today: Thanksgiving in times of trouble. It was made in a time of suffering, in the darkest days of the Civil War after the Union troops had lost almost every battle. In May of 1863, the Union armies had suffered severe defeats at Chancellorsville, even though they outnumbered the armies of the Confederacy 2-1. And even though Stonewall Jackson was accidentally killed in battle by his own men. The battles for Vicksburg were passed, but the federal troops that had been driven back to Chattanooga were besieged and in danger of starvation. Severe battles lay ahead in Tennessee, including the Battle of Missionary Ridge. Still ahead were the battle for Staunton, Lynchburg, Cold Harbor, Petersburg, Savannah, Sherman's devastating scorched earth march to Atlanta, and the fall of Richmond itself. It was in time of incredible death, destruction, horrible suffering. Today we have experienced only the tiniest taste of this kind of destructive bloodshed on our own soil with the Muslim terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center, the Pentagon, and the doomed flight that was diverted by brave passengers over Shanksville, Pennsylvania. But imagine the horrors of the Civil War with thousands and thousands of brave men and young teenage boys being ripped and torn and shredded by cannon and lead, spilling their precious blood across our land. At Gettysburg alone, over 60,000 men and boys were killed. 60,000 in the horrifying carnage. It was in the midst of these distressing times that Lincoln called the people together for a time of prayer and thanksgiving, and confessing their sins. And then in the midst of suffering, thanking God. Thanking God for his blessings and bounty. That was indeed a time of intense suffering such as our young nation had never seen before. And yet the believers in this land understood that the things of earth are never to affect our joy and thanksgiving, which is based on the eternal reality of God's grace and the promises of things to come. Lincoln understood that when he wrote, "No human counsel hath devised, nor hath any mortal hand worked out these great things. They are the gracious gifts of the Most High God, who, while dealing with us in anger for our sins, hath nevertheless remembered mercy. That remarkable Thanksgiving proclamation came at a pivotal point in Lincoln's spiritual life. It was written just 3 months after the Battle of Gettysburg, in which those 60,000 American men and boys lost their lives. And it was while walking among the graves at Gettysburg that Lincoln first committed his life to Christ. Let me give you a horrifying thought. It is a horrifying thought. But do you realize that 60,000 men and boys had to die to convict Lincoln of his sins and bring him to repentance? What will God have to do to turn our hearts to repentance and learn to give him thanks? Yes, thanksgiving in times of trouble. Listen to Lincoln's own words, which he later shared with a pastor. This is the quote. When I left Springfield, Illinois, to assume the presidency, I asked people to pray for me, but I was not a Christian. When I buried my son, the severest trial of my life, I was not a Christian. But when I went to Gettysburg and saw the graves of thousands of our soldiers, I then and there consecrated myself to Christ. Unquote. It took the death of 60,000 men and boys to bring Lincoln to repentance and faith in Christ. What will it take to bring us to true repentance? We must never forget that God uses times of suffering to refocus our attention on the things of heaven. God uses times of suffering to cause us to yearn for the things that cannot be seen. He uses times of suffering to help us understand what things are really important. And for that, we can be thankful and filled with joy because the best is yet to come. Writing to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul says, beginning in verse 16, "For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment." You think of that list I read you out of chapter 11. "For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen," all that suffering stuff around us, "but the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal." Oh, that we might be able to learn that lesson. Paul put his money where his mouth was. He didn't just tell us to give thanks when we're facing trouble. He set the example for us to follow. None of us have ever had that kind of horrible suffering that Paul faced day after day, week after week, year after year, decade after decade. It was not just one point of suffering, like his painfully bad vision. It was suffering that came by everything from wild animals to shipwrecks to mob attacks. If the old saying is true, variety is the spice of life, Paul's life was an entire pantry of spice. Our Lord Jesus Christ is also an example of his quiet suffering with a thankful heart. 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning in verse 19. "For this is thankworthy," that is, worthy of thanksgiving, "if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. For what glory is it if when you be buffeted for your faults you shall take it patiently? But if when you do well and suffer for it ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with God," Now here's our illustration. For even hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Remember how he started? This is thankworthy. This is worthy of thanksgiving. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. I wish we had time to look at it. Our time is up, and I will not hold you longer. But I had a whole section here on suffering, thanksgiving, and the spiritual warfare. Victory in spiritual warfare involving the lordship of Christ and giving of grateful thanks, walking in Christ, letting the peace of God rule in our hearts during those times to which we're called in one body, and be thankful, Colossians 3:15. If Christ is Lord of your life, you'll be able to be thankful in times of suffering. If he is not Lord of your life, and I'm not talking about lordship salvation, if he is not Lord in your life, you will never be thankful when you go through times of suffering. And yet that is commanded in Scripture. We have the example of Paul, who suffered more than you have ever or ever will possibly suffer. And of course, our Lord Jesus Christ. Giving thanks in times of trouble. We saw that taking place with that council in Charlestown, Massachusetts. We saw the first president, George Washington, mentioning thanksgiving in times of trouble. We saw Abraham Lincoln mentioning thanksgiving in times of trouble. Why is it that we try so hard to avoid thanksgiving in times of trouble? In the days of Hezekiah, who was only 25 years old when he began to reign, he was a very young man, it says he turned to the Lord his God with all his heart, and he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord according to all that David his father had taught him. From the very first day of his reign he did that. The people had been suffering, they'd gone through a time of religious depravity. But God moved the heart of one man, the leader of the nation. He called them to repentance, and God sent his blessing. Oh, that God would move on the heart of our president-elect like he moved on the heart of Hezekiah. Pray that God will spare our nation from destruction. Pray that God will cleanse our land. Remember what happened in the days of Hezekiah. And Hezekiah rejoiced in all the people that God had prepared the people, for the thing was done suddenly. God had prepared the people so that they were ready for national repentance. Are you prepared? Are you praying that God will prepare this great land of America for repentance and revival? It appears that God may have given us at least a temporary reprieve in this current presidential election. But we must also remember that sometimes God uses times of trouble to bring his people to a spirit of true thanksgiving. Gracious Heavenly Father, once again we thank you, for you are God. You have spared us so many times. You've shown your mercy even in the midst of chastenings for our sins. And we give you praise that indeed we can have thanksgiving in times of trouble, because the things of earth are temporal. The things that are not seen are eternal. And those are the things that you have promised to us as we look forward with eagerness and joy, and as we serve Jesus Christ now. Father, through this day, let us never forget the real reason for thanksgiving is not thanking God for Indians, not thanking God for immigrants, but thanking God. They're not even our nation, unfortunately, thanking God. They're simply thankful for immigrants. Thankful to whom? Vague unknown. Oh, Father, cause us to be a people that is thankful to you. For all that we have, all that we are, has come from your gracious hand. And we give you thanksgiving and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 794. Let all things now living rejoice with thanksgiving. Let's take